Well, good morning, everyone, and we've brought you all here today to provide an update on the 2023 Housing Action Plan. The Housing Action Plan marks a big step forward in getting housing built and getting it built faster in the City of Toronto. And I want to thank Councillor Bradford, the Chair of the Planning and Housing Committee, for joining me today and for all the heavy lifting that he's done on this work. And we're also joined by Gregg Lintern, the Chief Planner and Executive Director of City Planning, and Abby Bond, the Executive Director of the Housing Secretariat. And I would also like to start by recognizing former Mayor John Tory for his strong leadership on this plan and starting us on this ambitious path to get housing built. His tireless efforts last fall set the groundwork for this plan to be approved by Council, and I look forward to building on it, hitting top gear, as our housing staff say, with Council in the months ahead. We've made good progress in the last 8 years on housing, but we do know more needs to be done. And we want people from all walks of life to be able to call Toronto home, including both those who are here and newcomers. Back in December, Council voted to approve the Housing Action Plan, which takes a more aggressive approach to address the acute affordability and housing crisis facing our city. City staff were asked to return this March with a clear work plan for how it could be implemented. Staff have risen to the occasion, and next week at Executive Committee, the Action Plan will be on the table. The Housing Action Plan begins the process of updating the city's regulations so we can meet or exceed the target of actually building 285,000 homes over the next decade. This plan accommodates all kinds of housing, from student housing to affordable housing to housing targets for the Portlands and the waterfront. This plan will also remove exclusionary zoning that has focused growth in just a few areas of the city and prevented Torontonians from having diverse housing choices. The plan is also focused on leveraging public lands to unlock more housing supply. It prioritizes the preservation of existing rental homes and supports the development of a range of purpose-built rental homes through the new housing policies and programs. The plan also supports the community sector. This includes the nonprofit and co-op housing providers in Toronto so that they can grow their housing stock. The housing plan is bold, it's innovative, and it's aggressive. And I have every confidence that the plans outlined in this report will address the housing crisis. And while the Housing Action Plan outlines many initiatives to be taken over the next 3 years, the majority of actions can move forward this year and in 2024. Later this month, the city will release its new publicly accessible housing dashboard. This digital portal will track the city's development process and provide easily accessible information on where the city stands on housing projects across the city. This dashboard will make our housing plan and future goals transparent for all members of the public. Other critical initiatives will start as soon as April, including a recommendation to enable more multiplexes, up to 4 housing units, which will allow for gentle density in all Toronto neighborhoods. An update to the city's affordable housing programs, such as Housing Now and Open Door, a framework to support growth and modernization in the community and co-op housing sector. And we know that the time is now to take big strides towards activating all orders of government, as well as developers, landowners, housing providers, and we need to build homes now. This is an incredible opportunity during this council term to update and modernize housing policy here in Toronto in a way that facilitates the delivery of more housing supply, choice, and affordability for everyone. And we can do so in a way that continues to build strong, healthy communities that support our city's climate goals. This plan will be good for our city and good for the people of Toronto, the people who live here now, who want their families to continue to be able to live here, and the people who want to call Toronto home. I'd now like to introduce Councillor Brad Bradford, Chair of the Planning and Housing Committee, to say a few words.
Well, thanks very much. Good morning, everyone. It's great to be here with you. I want to start by offering my sincere thanks to Deputy Mayor McKelvie. There's no doubt that she has stepped up in such a tremendous way for a challenging time here in our city and is helping us all move forward. So thank you very much, Deputy Mayor. As Chair of the Planning and Housing Committee, I am incredibly proud to be here standing up this body of work that is online today for you to take a look at. And as you'll see from reading the report, there's absolutely no intention to take our foot off the pedal. In fact, here in Toronto, we are going full gas on housing. The promise of this city is predicated on the idea that if you want to build your life here, we want to have you. That means a home for everyone in the neighborhoods where they want to live, a home that they can afford, and one that meets their needs. Whether it's young couples looking to start a family, seniors who are looking to downsize and move into retirement, folks who are stepping off the tarmac at Pearson to build a new life in this country, or young people who are just looking to get started, the journey begins with a lock and key, the dignity of a roof over your head, and a place to call your own. What we have in front of us today is a bold plan that just a few short years ago would have been completely unthinkable. It's a testament to what is possible when we're brave enough to try something new. We all know it's time to break the status quo here at City Hall. And that means bringing an end to exclusionary zoning and simplifying the overly complicated set of rules that govern what individuals can build for themselves and their families. It means rethinking the outdated assumptions that we've held about how a city should grow and evolve so that we can continue to be a magnet for talent, investment, and immigration. It means that making sure our own policy objectives, the rules that we put in place as a city, are in line with our broader goals of affordability, sustainability, and equity, rather than being counter to them, which has too often, in fact, been the case. And for our part here at the City of Toronto, it's not just about getting out of the way, it's about proactively unlocking housing opportunities. That's why we're forging new partnerships with the not-for-profit and co-op housing organizations to help them build the capacity to increase the supply of community housing. It means a complete revamping of the Housing Now initiative to actually get shovels in the ground on new affordable rental projects. It means the creation of a robust public land strategy to ensure that we are using every last square inch of city-owned land to meet our demands for housing goals. In advance of the Housing Action Plan report coming to executive on March 21st, I've had the opportunity to do a citywide tour with our chief planner, Gregg Lintern, to go out and visit our planning districts. So far, as you've seen, I've been out to Scarborough, I've been out to Etobicoke, and we will be going to North York and the downtown planning segment as well to hear directly from our front lines team who will be implementing the plan to get their feedback and let them know that I stand behind them. I want them to know that the deputy mayor, myself, and council will stand behind them as they take the plan that's in front of us today and turn the words into action. I want them to know that we're taking the politics out of housing, because we know the future prosperity of our city absolutely depends on it. And they're going to lead the charge on this front. It's important to remember, for everyone who wants to call Toronto home, now and in the future, we are going to make certain that you have a place to call home, because Toronto is not Toronto without you. I'd like to thank again our Deputy Mayor for all of the incredible work she's doing, taking the reins, leading the city forward, and of course, our tremendous staff team in city planning, led by Gregg Lintern, and the Housing Secretariat, Abigail Bond, for the work they are doing. It is some of the most important stuff here in the city, and it's been a huge honor to work with them. So looking forward to doing the report at committee next week, and I'll turn it back to the Deputy Mayor for questions. Thank you very much.
Well, I think this is about an accountability framework for housing. So there is a work plan that will say what will happen over the next few years through the rest of the term. There are ambitious targets for 285,000 homes in the next 10 years. And it's also outlining the release of the dashboard that will happen so that there's transparency for the public on where we are with things. The other things in the report are laying out the different components and pieces that need to happen so that we can have a more streamlined process for approvals for housing in the City of Toronto. So this is very much the framework, the umbrella of where we need to go. And we're going to have many more reports next month in April at Planning and Housing, but also in the months to follow after that as well. Well, it's very much at the forefront of every discussion we have with the province. In fact, I'll be meeting with the Minister of Finance today. I will remind him of that promise around Bill 23. We are working with them around the audit and the terms of that audit. They have said that they want to have a full accounting, a full look at the costs that we think we will be incurred by us, the lost revenue. But they have made that commitment to keep us whole, and we're going to try to hold them to that as much as we can. Not yet. I think that we have to watch the conversations that happen with the province closely. They did come through for us on last year's funding that we needed for our 2022 COVID hangover shortfall, so to speak. So they have stepped up for 2022, and I'm hopeful that they'll step up for 2023 and also hold themselves to account for the promise they made about making us whole around Bill 23. I don't have details on where they're at in terms of selecting an auditor. I know that they're working on the terms between the two governments. That's in the discussion. That's part of what we're working through. We have 25 wonderful councillors that have been elected to represent their communities. I have every faith that they're able to make good decisions for the City of Toronto, and I look forward to all of us working collaboratively to continue the hard work that needs to be done on housing in the months before we have a new mayor in place. So a lot of this plan has at its basis or at its core some of the provincial requirements that have been put on us. And so we need to fulfill those requirements. So we are continuing to work in that direction. I am hopeful that our next mayor will continue to see that housing is a really important need in the City of Toronto. I think the residents of Toronto are going to tell our next mayor that over the next few months. So it's important that we keep moving forward. And I look forward to working with him or her when they're in place on June 26th. There's been extensive public consultation around many of these, and that consultation continues. So we are listening to the people of Toronto, and it's important that we listen to their views on this issue. This was a decision that was made 7 years ago by council. There was an extensive environmental assessment that was done. It's important that we move forward with this project. This is a 60-year-old piece of crumbling infrastructure in a state of poor repair. We need to move on with those repairs. We also have considerable sunk costs and investments that have been made, so it's important that we continue forward. Well, I mean, nobody wants to see sunk costs on anything. We made the decision. There is additional information that was given by city staff that I had shared with councillors. That information shows that reopening this debate doesn't have the potential to save money or save time and would need another EA process, and we have no guarantee of any outcome around that. In the meantime, we have infrastructure that's in a poor state of good repair, and we need to get on with it. It's important that we protect the people of Toronto by keeping their roads safe, and that's what we're going to do. Yeah, absolutely. I think that it's always tragic when we have a fire and we have a loss of life. And it's, in my new role, one of the most heartbreaking calls to get in the morning from the fire chief to hear. And I think this just underscores why it's so important that we have fire safety in place. And in the illegal rooming houses that we have, we know they are much more prone to fire and that they have a much higher likelihood of a bad outcome. And so that's why it's important that we continue with the legalization of rooming houses. We continue work with Toronto Fire to bring those illegal rooming houses into compliance so that they can keep residents safe. I think we can ask the chief planner for the timing on that, but I know that there was extensive consultation that's being done, and I think it's important that we give city staff time to cross the T's, dot the I's, so to speak, but he can speak to any of the other timing issues that have come up around that report.
I would not characterize it as deferring the multiplex. We were directed to go back and develop a zoning bylaw, which we've done. And shared that through a course of another round of consultation in February and into March. Just wrapped up that consultation last week. Various stakeholders wanted to understand and put, you know, the flesh on the bones of exactly what that proposal would be about. We are now presently considering what we heard in that round and formulating our final recommendations. We have to give statutory notice for that. And the next meeting of PHC is April the 27th. Well, I've stated that the target's ambitious, but it's good to have an ambitious target. The province gave us that number. A lot of the work that we are doing through the Housing Action Plan enables the achievement of that target. Some of it is direct through maybe a Housing Now program, modular housing, and some of the other initiatives that the city takes a direct role in. Some of it is program support. We're supporting others who achieve housing. Much of it, though, is enabling housing. So it's hard to get your hands on exactly how that will track because there are so many dependencies in the housing system. It could be interest rates, it could be labor market, it could be supply chain, and we've seen all that through the last 3 years. But we're confident that we can at least enable the achievement of that target, likely even exceed it. It does represent, though, from a construction capacity, industry capacity point of view, a very challenging number to hit because we've never really built at that rate. We approve a lot of housing here at City Hall, 2-to-1 ratio on approvals versus completions. We need to continue that pace to position the market to be able to achieve the target. Council took a decision on parking citywide, I believe it was in 21, to eliminate minimum parking requirements for residential development. So this report and their proposal for multiplex follows along that path. I believe the parking and the theme of that was really making the parking solution more market driven. I believe that vast majority of new multiplexes, if the units are price driven, certain, and you know, the science backs this up, lower cost, smaller units tend to attract tenants without cars. Higher rent, larger units will probably attract tenants with cars. I'm confident that if someone is building a multiplex, they'll provide parking that's adequate for the units that they're going to construct. You see across the city's residential neighborhoods a range of parking solutions, including driveways and garages and room for cars. And I think I'm pretty confident that will continue. I don't think we're there yet, Oliver, in terms of that part of the discussion. we're looking at multiplex permissions that are as of right. And I think it's going to be a case of you deciding to offer a unit, for that matter, with or without a parking space, and you deciding to rent a unit with or without a parking space, depending on your personal situation. If that unit doesn't have parking available to it, you may not choose to rent there if you have a car.
Yeah, I mean, certainly, as I said, we're looking to unlock housing opportunities. The city doesn't build the housing. We understand that. There's folks in the not-for-profit sector, there's co-op housing, and there's market housing. We need to create a framework where we're providing the enabling conditions for folks to make those investments and build and deliver the housing. And part of the work, you know, in terms of business transformation, in terms of our responding to the legislation from the province, is standing up a new program that helps us get through the approval process, get better outcomes more quickly. So, you know, the city's role is enabling. As I mentioned, we're ending exclusionary zoning. We will be coming forward with multiplexes very shortly. That's transformative in the Toronto context. We haven't been there. And if you go back to 2003, our first official plan, there's been a lot of changes over the past two decades in this city. It's time for our policy framework to match that and align the planning process with our housing goals, which is more housing for more people in more neighborhoods.
So the members of both the federal and the provincial government that I've met with have been very accepting of my current role, very willing to work together, and very collaborative. And I'm hopeful that that spirit of collaboration continues over the next three and a half months. Yeah. So right now, the discussions are very much based on what we sent them last week, and that is the $48 million for supportive housing wraparound supports, as well as the funding for COVID-19 hangover, so for the shortfalls that we're having from transit and other related things. I haven't entered into those other conversations yet. They'll be oncoming and working with our wonderful city staff, working with their staff as well. Any other questions? Has it? Okay. Everybody has been really wonderful, especially the staff in the Office of the Mayor. They have been very kind and accepting of my current situation, my current position, and we're all working hard, and our priority remains serving the residents of Toronto. Okay. Thank you.